Everybody, welcome. A warm welcome on behalf of the organization, which is the Fundació Catalunya La Pedrera and the Iconic Houses Network. Welcome at the third conference, the third international conference, Iconic Houses Conference. And we are very happy to be here in La Pedrera, in the heart of Catalan modernism. Today, you will get a crash course about the latest developments in this region, not only Spain, but also in the countries that surround the Mediterranean. Let me see. We have been very fortunate to find in La Pedrera a partner to organize this day for you. Last year, we were at the Victoria and Albert Museum in London. And before we started our career in conferences in Palm Springs in the United States. But La Pedrera has, of course, it is a house, but it also has these wonderful facilities with this auditorium. So it makes it very convenient to host all of you. And we are happy with the team we worked with. It was an amazing team, very dedicated and professional, and above all, passionate. We have also an impressive lineup of speakers for you. We decided to have a lot of speakers representing many different houses because we wanted to give you the overview of what's going on. There are so many houses that are new on the scene that we thought we give you all this information on one day and inspire you for further research and visiting them. And today in our audience, we have almost 50 houses presenting, almost 50 people presenting these iconic houses. So we have a very diverse audience from all over the world. We have 17 different nations here. In your bag, you'll find a reader. We prepared a reader for you. The program is in it, but also interviews with all the speakers. So we won't have long introductions. You can read all about their backgrounds and the interviews. So to give you more information about them. And to give you a little bit of background about the Iconic Houses Network, because our members are here, they know all about it, but I see also a lot of new faces who might not be so familiar with our short history. And so a little bit of background about the Iconic Houses Network. The idea began in 2008, and I started to research houses around the world from the 20th century that were open to the public as a house museum. I researched this between 2008 and 2011. Then I met with the director of the Alvar Aalto Foundation, and she thought, like me, that it would be interesting to connect all the directors of these houses, and set up a network, a professional network where people can share best practices, but also to have a public website so travelers and people interested in architecture could find all these houses. In 2012, we developed the website and we launched it in Los Angeles at the Schindler House. And without having any budget, we have since then a lot of free publicity. Well, first I'll show you the people behind the network. There's an organizing committee with Iveta Cerna, the second from above. She's here today, the director of Villa Tugendhat. Kimberly Meyer, director of the Mack Center in Los Angeles, the house of designed by Rudolf Schindler. Then Susanna Pettersson, she was director of the Alvar Aalto Foundation, now director of the Athenaeum Art Museum in Helsinki. And Linda Wegener, director of Falling Water by Frank Lloyd Wright. But in the 2 years of our public existence, we were happy to have a lot of publicity. So we've been really working hard to get the word out that we exist and to get the Iconic Houses website on the radar of everyone. We even made it to the top five of Google-based architecture maps. The website is in fact a collection of houses that are member of our network, But the added value of this website is that it is a central directory online for travelers to find interesting destinations. But it is also interesting for the houses that team up with the network that they show that they exist, because there are so many more houses than you might think, and you can all find them here listed on, by the name of the house or by the name of the architect. But it is more than a directory. The existence of the website also stimulates people from all over the world to share their knowledge with us. So a lot of information comes to the network, and we can connect people and we can inform them on many different things that could be beneficial for them. There are now 120 houses listed on the site, and we are in we are talking with many more houses. So I expect that in 2015 we have 150 houses listed. We had 130,000 visitors in 2 years' time, of which 90,000 were unique visitors. Our ambition is that we would like to list, of course, all houses in the world from the 20th century that are open to the public. And I think in the end, because it is a quite small niche of museums, I think there may be not more than 200 and 250. But we see that there are many new houses on the scene. I'll show you a few later on. So maybe it is a very popular kind of museum, so maybe it will be grow much more in the future. So where the website is a sort of static collection, once in a while new houses added. Our Facebook is interactive, and we share news from all our members' houses, and all other related info we just come across during our research. So here, if you're really interested in what's going on, all the talks, all the special openings, concerts, you can find it on our Facebook. And we have about 4,000 page views a week. We also want to deepen the knowledge about these houses. For instance, we have these lectures about iconic houses. Some of them are here today. Tim Benton lectured about the Cabanon of Le Corbusier. He will be later on in our program. So we want to educate the visitors of our website. We want to educate our members. And for the members, we have a special area where we share documents about house museum practice. There are notes from our directors' meetings. There is a forum in the near future with Q&A. So it really stimulates the curators, the directors, the custodians, or owners of these houses to share their knowledge. We would like to play a role in professionalizing the sector and stimulate the interest in the houses through a central PR and marketing strategy. In the end, we might be able to also play a role in preventing iconic houses from demolition. I told you that all information is coming to the Iconic Houses Network. For instance, the Getty Center in Los Angeles contacted us and asked us to share with you that there is a recent program with grants for 20th century iconic architecture. It's very nice that of the 10 first buildings that have been given a grant, there are three houses, and they are all a member of our network. For instance, the Roby House got a grant from $50,000, and it will be used to make a maintenance plan for the house, and this maintenance plan can then be exemplary for other Frank Lloyd Wright structures. One of the other houses that received a grant is Eames House in Los Angeles, also to make a conservation management plan. And the apartment of Le Corbusier in Paris received a grant. So this sort of information, we can help our members to stress that this is there and that might help them in the future. Here are some facts and figures. The growth of 20th century house museums, based on a study from 2010, we see that it started in the 50s, and the earliest house 20th century house museums were the houses by Frank Lloyd Wright. Immediately after Frank Lloyd Wright died, his both houses, Taliesin and Taliesin West, became a museum. And soon after that, Falling Water, when the Kaufman family died, it was donated to the Pennsylvania Conservation Agency, and Falling Water became a museum. But what is really obvious is that in the 90s you see a growth of house museums. And for instance, in the 1985 to 1990, the Rietveld-Schreuder House in Utrecht became a house museum, the Villa Savoy, Casa Barragan, and the Eames House. Then between 1990 and 1995, the Aalto Houses, Villa Tugendhat, and the Schindler House became house museums. And many of these, there are seven house museums listed also as UNESCO heritage, and that was also in the 90s. So there was a growing interest in this kind of domestic heritage. Between 1995 and 2000, La Pedrera, the Roby House, and Casa Batlló became a house museum. And now, between 2010 and 2015, I made a quick scan with in our members and within my own research of the past years. And we see amazing growth until more than 30. It doesn't even fit here on the screen. And despite of the economic crisis in big parts of Europe, you see a trend of private initiatives, people that care so much about this heritage and open up to the public. And so I'm happy to see that. The distribution of these house museums, you can see here, they're listed by country. Then you see a list of museums that were made in an inventory in 2010. And then the iconic houses on the map today. And you see at the bottom here, there are 44 houses in the USA, whether all the other countries not even have five houses. So in the United States, they are probably a very young country. And in Europe, we have a lot of medieval architecture. We have chateaus. So there's much more history to compete with. And you see now today, we have 30 of these American houses on the map. But you see also that we have 13 in Spain and 13 in France, 12 in the Netherlands, and 8 in Germany. And so, but most of them are in the United States. Here you see that what we just saw in North America met the most, then Europe, and then only very, very few in the other continents. Now, how come? It's not because our research is not good enough, but in China, there is no capitalism. So without capitalism, without any money, there are no private clients who wants to show off with interesting architecture. In Japan, there are many earthquakes. So when there's an earthquake, the soil is much more worth than the structure that is built on it. So they just replace it by something else. And but I know that in South America there must be many more. So there is really a lot to find out. But communication between South America is quite hard. But we want to do more effort to get these houses on the map as well. In the quick scan I just mentioned, these are those 30 houses. Many of them are here today. I will briefly show them so you have a visual image of them. This is Casa Broner on Ibiza by Erik Broner. This is Canlis, the house by Jorn Utzon at Mallorca. Casa Blok here in Barcelona. House Schminke in Leubau by Hans Scharoen. De Dageraad, a housing complex in the Netherlands. The house of Jean Prouvé in Nancy. Sunnylands and Gardens in Rancho Mirage, California. The house of Bruno Tautz Siedlung in Berlin. This is social housing in the Netherlands. Casa del Puente, Amancio Williams. Jean Berlani House, Paul Ancar in Brussels. A house in Groet, the Netherlands, by Merkelbach and Karstens. The Jurkovic House in Brno. Paul Rudolph's own house in New York. Torre Belles Guard here in Barcelona. Adolf Loos apartment and gallery. And Bovarul, Casa Bovarul, Casa Amatie, Casa Leo Morera. The Bach House in Chicago by Frank Lloyd Wright. Haag House by Le Corbusier in Pessac. Isaacon Gallery in London, the Oscar Hansen House in Poland, Casa Amatier here in Paseo de Gracia, Eileen Gray's house, the Melnikov House, next year open to the public, the Perlot House at Fire Island, New York, Villa Cavrois in Croix by Rob Malestevan, the Dyed House by Arthur Erickson in Canada, Maison van Doesburg in Meudon, and Casa Vicens by Gaudi here in Barcelona. This leads me to the theme of today. We are going to give you a crash course about the houses around the Mediterranean. You know now a little bit about our background. For all of us, we will have lots of time today to gather during the lunch and during the coffee and the tea break. But we are curious to know how many in the audience, I'm going to ask you three questions. If people who are involved professionally with running an iconic house, can they raise their hands so we have an impression how many of you are on a daily basis working with an iconic house? Okay, and how many of you here in the audience are architect, restoration architect, and involved in that way? Uh-huh. And then how many of you are not involved in no way whatsoever and are here just because you love domestic architecture? Okay, almost as many as architects. The one thing we all share is the passion for this domestic heritage, and for the professionals this day will be a day of peer learning and inspiration, and for the interested attendees, a look behind the scenes. From March onwards, we have prepared this program for you. We formed a standing committee of local experts, and the standing committee consists of Jordi Falgas, who will also be your moderator of the day, the director of Casa Mazó in Girona, Susanna Landrove, director of Docomomo Iberico. She will be the moderator in the afternoon debate. Santiago Alcolea Blanche, he will be your keynote speaker and introduce the whole theme to you in the morning. And we have been digging here in Spain and the other Mediterranean countries what we could show you. The result is a program that gives you an overview of the status quo of the variety of 13 houses in Spain, France, and Italy. And I'll show them briefly here to you in chronological order. La Pedrera, Amatier, Leo Morera, Batlló, Casa Mazó, Eileen Gray, the Harg House, Villa Girasole near Verona in Italy, Casa Bloch and La Ricarda, Casa Broner, Canlis. And this will be the last speaker of today, Oscar Tusquets. This house, Villa Vittoria, is not open to the public, but it is a very enigmatic design, and Oscar Tusquets is a very important Spanish architect, and we are very happy that he is going to unveil a little bit about this house. I cannot wait to hear all the stories, so let's start the day, and let me give the floor to Marga Fisa, the cultural director of La Pedrera. Please, Marga, the floor is yours.